As the proud father of a courageous, kind, and empathetic 24-year-old transgender daughter, I feel compelled to share our family's journey with gender-affirming care and address some of the most harmful misinformation surrounding it. In the past year, the United States has experienced a surge of anti-transgender legislation, with bills targeting transgender individuals introduced in nearly every state. These bills, and the lawmakers behind them, are supported by well-funded anti-LGBTQ+ organizations such as the Alliance Defending Freedom, which received over $96 million in contributions and grants in its 2022 fiscal year. What is most distressing is this network's focus on banning gender-affirming care for adolescents, a ban now enacted in 25 states. From our own experience, we know just how radical and cruel these laws are. When our daughter came out as transgender shortly before her 16th birthday, we listened intently, striving to understand her struggles and how best to support her. Like many parents of transgender children, we initially questioned whether this was just a phase she would outgrow. In hindsight, we didn't fully grasp what it meant for her to be transgender, but we were acutely aware that she was suffering. Misconceptions and realizations. One of the most common misconceptions about being transgender is that it reflects a choice. This misconception is closely related to the false narrative of a social contagion, which suggests that children are influenced to identify as transgender by peer pressure, particularly through social media. However, when we consulted experts in transgender care, we learned what a federal court had recognized: being transgender is not a preference but a medically recognized condition with a biological basis, an innate and non-alterable status. In response to our questioning whether our daughter was going through a phase, her medical and mental health care team informed us that a transgender individual is someone who consistently, persistently, and insistently identifies as a different gender than their sex assigned at birth. This is in contrast to cisgender, non-transgender, people who may experiment with gender expression that does not conform to stereotypical gender norms. The importance of timely intervention. We came to another important realization on our family's transition journey: inaction is not a neutral option. For adolescents experiencing gender dysphoria, non-intervention increases the risk of adverse mental and physical health outcomes. Gender dysphoria is a medically recognized condition characterized by debilitating distress and anxiety due to the incongruence between a person's gender identity and their sex assigned at birth. The onset of puberty and its associated development of secondary sex characteristics can trigger or worsen gender dysphoria. Our daughter's struggle and the myths of gender-affirming care. Our daughter experienced intense distress driven by dysphoria during puberty. In hindsight, we realized that we failed her by not acting with the necessary urgency. Critics of gender-affirming care for adolescents falsely claim that children are rushed into such care, but the opposite is true. A recent study found that the median wait time for transgender adolescents is 10 months between contacting a clinic and receiving puberty blockers or cross-sex hormones. This long wait reflects both the care and deliberation families invest in these decisions and the scarcity of qualified medical professionals providing such care. For adolescents approaching puberty, puberty-blocking medicines may be appropriate to delay the development of secondary sex characteristics that do not align with their gender identity. This intervention is fully reversible. Subsequently, cross-sex hormone treatment can further alleviate gender dysphoria by aligning the body more closely with the individual's gender identity. Our daughter experienced significant relief from her depression and dysphoria after starting puberty blockers and hormone therapy. She has openly stated that she may not have survived her teen years without this medically necessary care. Those who oppose this care offer no medically approved alternative therapy. Parental rights and medical consensus. The same anti-LGBTQ+ groups promoting bans on gender-affirming care are also pushing for book bans under the guise of parental rights. If parents have the right to direct what their children read, surely they must have the right to direct their adolescents' medical care in consultation with their children's doctors. As a former registered Republican, I know there is nothing conservative about inserting the state between a child and their parents and physicians who understand the best care for that child. Politicians should stay out of families' medical decisions, especially when those decisions are in line with medical consensus. Legal and medical perspectives. Courts of law, unlike the political arena where ideologues can promote junk science, make decisions based on evidence presented under stringent rules. Nearly every U.S. trial court considering evidence and challenges to bans on gender-affirming care has concluded that such care is medically necessary, safe, effective, and supported by every major medical association in the country. Last year, a trial court in Montana, not known for liberal leanings, blocked the enforcement of the state's newly enacted ban on gender-affirming care. The court noted, "The court is forced to conclude that the purported purpose given for the statute is disingenuous. It seems more likely that the statute's purpose is to ban an outcome deemed undesirable by the Montana legislature, veiled as protection for minors. The legislative record is replete with animus toward transgender persons, mischaracterizations of the treatments prescribed by the statute, and statements from individual legislators suggesting personal, moral, or religious disapproval of gender transition. This description applies to any of the 25 state laws banning gender-affirming care. Politicians should stop trying to impose one-size-fits-all, statewide mandates and interfering in the private, individualized medical decisions of families with transgender children and their physicians."